A little bit about Western University, where I'm from. It's one of Canada's oldest universities, founded in 1878. We're the seventh largest university in Canada with about 40,000 undergraduate and graduate students. We have one of the top business schools in the world, a highly respected medical school, and our science and engineering faculties are leaders in materials and surface science within Canada. We're located in London, Ontario, which is somewhere about halfway between Toronto and Detroit. And this is the Great Lakes regions of Southern Ontario. Surface Science Western, which is the lab I'm the director of, is Canada's leading surface analysis and materials characterization facility. We have 15 full-time staff scientists with expertise in everything from chemistry, geology, engineering, physics, metallurgy, and materials science. We're kind of interesting, we're run as a self-sustaining business unit for Western. And so we have a very broad user base, which includes not just Western graduate students and faculty. We work with university groups from around the world, helping them with their surface analysis and materials characterization problems. As well, we work with 150 to 200 different companies from across North America annually, issuing somewhere around 1,000 technical reports per year. We have a wide range of instrumentation, which you can see here. Strong focus in XPS as well as SIMS techniques. We have a couple of dynamic SIMS as well as a TOF SIMS system, a number of SEMs with unique capabilities, and then a whole range of other stuff that you can see here. So, new frontiers in chemical state analysis using X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. A little bit of background about this. Over the years, myself and others within the XPS community have noticed that there's been some issues in the literature with interpretation of XPS spectra, and particularly the interpretation of transition metal XPS spectra. There's been somewhat of a proliferation of faulty data where ongoing citing of erroneously interpreted data, and this is even showing up in high impact and well-regarded journals. The point is that XPS is not just a point and shoot type of technique. There is a need for expertise on both the analysis side as well as the interpretation side. I and many in the XPS community have been working to fix this. And these are just some of the publications that have been put forward in that respect. I'll note that this is not just an XPS issue. There are issues in the broader analytical community with other techniques as well. But I'll be focusing on XPS here. We started this work back in around 2003, 2004, where we started looking at iron and chromium. And we were noticing that, again, that there was a lot of issues in the literature. And so we took it upon ourselves to kind of start going through some of the transition metals and really figuring out ways to interpret these things and how to quantify and how to quantify the different species within materials. And some of these publications have been pretty highly cited, and this is just a list of some of them that we've published throughout the years. A lot of the work was done on the instrument in the foreground. That's the Kratos Axis Ultra. We received that instrument back in 1999. The one in the background is the Kratos Axis Nova. It's a bit more of an industrial-based instrument where you can load up a whole bunch of samples and run a long time. We recently, 2 years ago, replaced the Ultra with the latest and greatest Kratos Axis Supra. This is a high-end research instrument with aluminum K-alpha source, a silver source. You can heat samples in situ up to 800 degrees, cool them down to liquid nitrogen temperatures. We have a fracture system so that you can fracture samples so that you're looking at pristine surfaces when you're analyzing them. It also comes with a gas cluster ion source, which allows you to do depth profiling and cleaning of materials without reducing the materials that was a problem with some of the older monoatomic sources. For those of you that are new to XPS, this is just a brief summary of it. You shine X-rays at the surface, in this case, aluminum K-alpha X-rays. You knock out a photoelectron from the core. You can then measure the kinetic energy of that photoelectron, and using the Einstein equation, you can figure out what that binding energy was within the core. And the binding energies of those core electrons tell you what elements are present. So you can do what's called a survey scan, where you can measure a wide range of binding energies and quantify how much of the different elements are present. Or you can do what's called a high resolution scan to figure out the chemical state of those elements. So if you expand on the carbon 1s peak here, you get this high resolution spectrum where you have so much carbon bound to carbon, you have on the other end carbon bound to 3 fluorines, carbon bound to 2 fluorines, et cetera. And it's a very surface sensitive technique. You're looking at the outer 3 to 10 nanometers of the surface. So that's the strength of XPS. So chemical state determination. The theory is that you get small shifts in core level binding energies, and those are indicative of chemical state changes. If you can tell, you can tell whether you have a metal versus the oxide, silica versus silicone, a fluoride versus fluorocarbon, various states of carbon. As you withdraw valence electron charge, you decrease shielding, increase the binding energy in those core electrons. As you add valence electron charge, you increase shielding and get a decrease in binding energy. In practice, for most elements with uncomplicated peak shapes, a simple binding energy reference is sufficient. So that's fairly easy. You can get these things from things like the NIST database or the Phi Handbook, or there's other online databases that you can get these this information from. And literature values range from very good. In some cases, it's incomplete. We don't have binding energy references for some compounds. There's a lot of compounds out there. And sometimes wrong. So some things are published, and as I mentioned, you get a proliferation of faulty data and faulty interpretation. How do you believe the literature? You have to do your homework. Some of the things you can do, you can check whether the instrument has been calibrated. Are they talking about what they're using for charge referencing? So insulating samples, you need to do a charge correction, whether that be to the adventitious carbon that's on the surface of the sample or a known compound within the sample. So those things should be listed in the literature that you're looking at. When you get into the transition metal species, there's a whole series of further complications. You get contributions from things like spin orbit splitting. You can have asymmetric peak shapes, loss and shakeup structure. The big one is multiplet splitting that shows up with materials that have unpaired electrons. And you can have a lot of overlapping binding energies and peak shapes for many of these species. So this is unique to the transition metals. What does that all mean? Well, spin orbit splitting, if you have an S level that you're looking at, that's only a nice single peak, so it's very easy to interpret. If you have the P, B, and F levels, these give rise to spin orbit splitting or J to J coupling. When you see these kind of peaks, you should look at the peak areas should match with theory. So the 2P3 halves peak should be twice the size of the 2P1 half peak. If you're looking at the D peaks, it's a 3-to-2 ratio. If you're looking at the F peaks, it's a 4-to-3 ratio. And if that's not the case, that might be indicative that there's something else present there. For conductive species or metallic species, you can get interaction of core electrons with a conduction band, and this shows up as small losses of kinetic energy in the electrons. And this shows up as this asymmetric tail on these metallic peaks. So you have to factor that sort of thing in when you want to curve fit or quantify your materials. Plasma and loss structure is not necessarily an issue with high resolution spectra, but in survey spectra, we've seen plasma and loss peaks misidentified as other species when really they just belong to the main element that they're coming from. Shakeup structures. You can get this finite probability that an ion will be left in an excited state, a few eV above the ground state. And when this happens, the kinetic energy will be, of those emitted electrons will be reduced. The classic case for this is, say, the copper 2P spectrum of copper 2 species. So you have the main peak and then these shake-up structures at some binding energies above the main peak. Multiple splitting arises when you have unpaired electrons. So for example, in chromium 3, we have 3P6, 3D3, so we have 3 unpaired D electrons. And when you get a core vacancy made by photoionization, you can get coupling between those unpaired electrons in the core with the unpaired electrons in the shell. And this gives you a number of final states that will be seen in the spectrum. And this is where we start to really see a lot of issues in the literature. We did see a lot of issues in the literature, where people were actually, instead of recognizing that this whole peak envelope was chromium 3 or whatever species you were looking at, they were trying to assign all these things to different chemical states. So they would say, well, this is chromium 2, chromium 3, chromium 4. I've even seen chromium 5, even though I don't know that ever even exists, chromium 6 up here, when really all they had was chromium 3. And we were seeing that quite a bit in the literature. Now, multiple splitting has been known for a long time. Back in the 70s, Gupta and Sen did a bunch of modeling that went through and looked at all the different multiple splitting that would be possible with the transition metals. So it was known. If you look at the transition metal series, the ones in red will show significant multiple splitting. The ones in green have no unpaired electrons, so therefore they do not show multiple splitting. And the ones in yellow, while technically they do have multiple splitting, it's generally not well resolved or it shows up as peak bonding only. And so with all these complications, the question is, well, how do we accurately identify the species that are present? And then how do we quantify the amount of those species that are present? And that's something that wasn't really being done. People weren't, figuring out how much of each of different things were there. And our solution to this was developing a series of standardized fitting procedures for the spectra that takes into account all these phenomena. So it takes into account spin over splitting, PK symmetries, loss structures, shade up structures, and multiple splitting. And then using the total photoelectron yield for each species to determine of the percentage of each species within an unknown sample. So what does that look like? So species without multiple splitting are a little more simple. Say something like scandium, we have to take into account that the metal is an asymmetric peak shape. Something like scandium 3 oxide doesn't have any multiple splitting. So it's a nice doublet of a 2-to-1 peak area ratio. The peaks will have specific separations between them that we need to constrain. The full width half maxes we can constrain. And you can come up with this kind of peak fitting regime that allows you to quantify how much of the different species. So it's relatively straightforward. Same thing again for something like titanium, where you have a mix of metals, some suboxides in here, and then the titanium 4 oxide as well up here. And again, you can quantify what those are. So those are fairly straightforward when you don't have the multiple splitting. When we look at things with significant multiple splitting, and I mentioned chromium before, the literature out there was not very good at all. They didn't have an understanding. They were trying to assign chemistries to things that were not actually changes in chemistry, but they were changing because of these multiple split peak shapes. Even databases were quoting a single peak binding energy for compounds that are known to have multiply split peaks. So how do you assign a single peak value when you have multiple peaks? Like, that doesn't make any sense. Some of the issues may have been resolution of the older instruments, but mostly it was just a misunderstanding about what was going on with these spectra. And so if we look at a bunch of standard samples, we've seen the chromium 3 oxide before, we can mimic this peak shape using a series of peaks with certain full width half maxes, certain peak areas, certain binding energies, all constrained so that when we're fitting these into the unknown spectrum, we're basically fitting in models of standard spectra. And we can take that for chromium hydroxide, where we can use a single peak with a broad peak that fits in there. Something like chromium 6 has a nice sharp peak shape because it does not have multiple splitting. So it's a nice single peak. And then you develop these kind of peak fitting parameters that take into account all of this. Apply them to your unknown spectra, and then we can then pull out and quantify the different species that are present. And these peak fitting parameters work over and over again. And so you kind of set them up once and keep applying them to your spectra. And so you now have a system where you can quantify very easily the different things that are in your systems. And you can see here changes here. This was a decorative chrome plating. Before treatment, it was mostly metal and hydroxide on the surface. And after surface cleaning treatment, we drop the amount of metal a little bit, but we're adding some more straight chrome oxide in amongst the chromium hydroxide. Another example, in this case, we can actually see the presence of chromium 6 within the material. And chromium 6 is the toxic form of chrome, and so people want to get rid of that. So we need to be able to quantify that within these species. If we look at something like nickel, this is where you really start seeing some changes in peak shapes. The metal itself, we have an asymmetric peak shape with some satellite structure up here. But if we look at something like nickel oxide versus nickel 2 hydroxide, you can see that the peak shapes are very unique. And so the peak shape itself is diagnostic of what species we have. Again, if we look at something like the chromate and the ferrite and then the nickel 3 species, again, very different peak shapes. So the peak shapes themselves are diagnostics of the different species that we're looking at. So instead of just a binding energy shift, all these things kind of overlap in the same binding energy range. So that doesn't tell us anything, but the shapes of the peaks do tell us lots about what's going on here. And so we then develop these tables that list binding energy of all the different peaks that are under there, their full width half max, their area percentages, their separation. And what that allows us to do is to take this information and go from a variety of different software packages, plug that information in, and you can even change things based on the resolution of your instruments. So you can widen peaks or narrow peaks based on your instrument resolution. And so it allows you, instead of just using the shape of a spectrum and try to transfer that between software packages, which is really not possible to do and has other problems with it based on resolution of instruments, you can use these sorts of peak fitting parameters to apply this information to all sorts of different instruments. And so it's a more robust way of doing it. And then when you do that, you take the total photoelectron yield of the species present, and you can put these into various situations and again, pull out how much of the different species you have. So much metal, so much oxide, so much hydroxide. And it works for a variety of different species. And we've been using this for, I guess, 15 years now. And it's been very successful. If you want to visualize what you're doing, you look at this and it's just this whole mess of peaks. You know, like, well, it means just throwing in a whole bunch of peaks. No, we're not. What we're doing is we're fitting whole spectra under these peak envelopes. And it's not a new concept. People have been doing this in infrared spectroscopy and other spectroscopies for years. It's just that the way we're doing it allows us to look at it or be able to apply this to data using different instrument settings, using different instruments. So it's a more robust fitting way of doing it. So once we get those kind of information out of those peaks, you know, how much oxide, how much hydroxide you have on top of metal, we can actually do thin film calculations. In the olden days, they would look at, based on the calculations of Carlson and Strohmeyer, you could plug in the amount of oxide on top of the metal, use the inelastic mean free paths for the different species and pull out a number of how thick your oxide is. So we've improved on that a little bit by using, now that we have information on how much oxide, hydroxide, or a variety of different oxides, you know, in more complicated cases, if we use a weighted average of those amounts of oxides, as well as a weighted average of the inelastic mean free path, we get a little more accurate measurement of the thin films. And we've developed a bunch of calculators where we can just plug the numbers in. Once we've done the curve fitting, we plug the numbers in, we pop out the amount of the film thicknesses. And we've done that for things like chromium and iron and titanium, and et cetera. And so for example, in this one where we have a very small amount of the metal underneath, we get a thin film of around 6.2 nanometers. Now note that these kind of simple calculations are not, they don't go into the depth of what other things can do, same things like quasis analysis or angle resolve type analyses, but it is a quick way of looking at a series of samples to see changes in oxide film thickness. So similar work we've done for manganese, cobalt, iron. With manganese, you have manganese 6 and 7 oxides, oxyhydroxide, hydroxides. So there's lots of complications there. Cobalt's another one with a whole bunch of different mixed oxides, different oxide species that are present. Iron is probably the most complicated and the most difficult one to do speciation on. You have iron 2 and iron 3 species. things like FeO, Fe304, Fe203, and then different phases, so alpha and gamma, there's some beta phases and such. Each of them are going to have unique multiple structure and shake-up satellites. They all have overlapping binding energies. The 2P3 half satellite structures overlap with the Fe2P1 half metallic peaks. So as your oxide hydroxide mixture grows, our ability to quantify or even identify the species that are present decreases. If you have two species plus the metal, it's very good. If you have three species plus the metal, it's moderate to good. And four or more species, you're just unlikely to be able to reliably say anything beyond you have Fe2 and Fe3 species present. With these kind of analyses, if you can get complementary analysis information from, say, Raman or grazing angle XRD, that's very useful to help prove to yourself that that's, you know, what you're seeing is real. With that being said, it does work. So you can see this kind of mess of peaks underneath here. We can quantify, you know, how much Fe203 versus how much Fe304. For series of samples, even though, I mean, you look at this and you go, how can you possibly see much changes in there? But there's enough small changes in the peak shape and enough binding energy shifts in there that we can see monitor changes from very similar samples as we go through similar samples. So we see the top one has so much FeO, a little bit more in the bottom. The Fe203 amount is much more on the top one versus the bottom one, etc. And so once we've done all that kind of curve fitting and figuring out what chemical states we have, we can then combine that data with the data we get from our survey scans. So survey scans tells us how much of the different elements are present. So we factor all this together, and then using simple math, we can get kind of a very complete picture of what's going on at these surfaces. So this is a nickel chrome molybdenum alloy that's been treated to a variety of different electrochemical treatments. And we can see changes within that oxide based on what's there. So we have so much of our metal and then a variety of different oxides all kind of quantified at that surface. And as we change systems, we see that from this one, the nickel hydroxide, there's not a lot. We go to this one, it's a lot more nickel hydroxide. It's also a thicker overall oxide system where we're seeing much less metal compared to here. So you can go through and see these changes together. One caveat with this sort of analysis is not taking into effect depth changes. And so usually when you're growing these sorts of oxides, you might have an oxide next to the metal, and then your hydroxides or hydrated oxides will be on your surface. And that sort of work you would need to do, again, either depth profiling or angle resolve work to kind of elucidate what you have there as well. Our lab is doing a lot of work with company called the Nuclear Waste Management Organization. And this is an entity that's designed to figure out how Canada is going to store its spent nuclear waste underground for the next 10,000 to a million years. And so what they're looking at is building these steel containers that are clad in copper, pure copper. And copper in the environment can stick around as pure copper for a long time. And then it will be buried underground for, like I say, the next 10,000 to a million years, hopefully undisturbed. And so we're doing a lot of work on this, the copper materials. And part of that work involves doing a lot of X-ray photo electron spectroscopy to figure out what chemical states are being made at these surfaces under various conditions. And so if you look at copper, and if you look at the copper 2P spectrum, for copper 2P spectrum for things like the metal and copper 1 species, it's a nice single peak that overlaps each other. So you can't get a lot of information out of that. But for copper 2 species, you see all this shakeup structure and how it changes in shape and position as we change for the different species. So that's one thing you can look at when you're looking at copper. The other thing that's kind of novel is we've done a lot of work looking at the copper LMM Auger structure and the position and the shape of that. And you can see the positions and shape. So these are copper one species. The positions change a lot and the shapes change a lot. And the same thing goes for the copper two species, which also shows different position and shape changes. And so we're going to be able to use that. And so there's a variety of different ways we've looked at copper. You can look at just straight binding energies of the main 2P3 halves peak. You can look at the Auger parameter, which is a combination of the peak position of the main peak of the copper 2P3 halves peak and the copper Auger peak. And that gives you information about what species you have and helps you quantify or helps you tell you what you have. We've done calculations where we look at the amount of the shakeup satellite versus the main peak. And we do calculations where we can figure out, okay, how much copper two do we have versus how much copper one and copper zero that we have. So we can look at those sorts of things. And then we can do curve fitting, as we've done before, of the LMM satellite or LMM Auger peak. And that's been very successful looking at the amount of different species that are present. And so we combine all those things and we can get a very complete picture of what's happening with copper in systems. And finally, this is a web page that I operate called the X-ray Photoelectron Spectroscopy Reference Pages. It's kind of a repository of tips and binding energies and how to go about doing curve fitting for XPS, pitfalls and all sorts of things. So it gets a lot of use, gets around 25,000 hits a month from XPS users around the world. And it's a nice repository of techniques for people. And that's it. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to take them.